We have some intriguing kinds of things coming up in terms of the internet. So what you're going to get here is Enrique. And you'll notice on the front, I should have put a period in BS degree and MS degree, but I didn't. But it is a BS degree and an MS degree. And Enrique is, if you don't already know, a astronomer person, and he does star stuff. And I'm going to probably talk to him about that as a potential Democratic Party fundraiser. But in his capacity as the NAACP president and a concerned citizen, he became very interested in things related to the internet, to fake news, to conspiracy theories. And I know that last year when I was not here, he presented and people were very, very intrigued with what he had to say and suggested him again. So he is here to update us about all of that. So in addition to everything I said on the front of the front page, Enrique just got married.
Yay! Yay! It makes you smile.
What a honeymoon.
I know. So here he is to talk about fake news, social media, misinformation, and whatever he wants to talk about, actually. And we have two cakes and in the refrigerator Pepsi products afterwards if you would like to stay. Yes, sir.
The numbers on demographics?
Uh-huh.
Are you missing some decimals?
Where?
Like 600 billion?
Yeah, I was confused by that
yeah.
as well.
Should be 6.0.
Oh, billion. Yeah,
yeah. Billion, yeah. 6
billion. Okay. Anybody else?
And 2 billion.
Where are we looking?
Front.
Right. Right here.
See, this should be like 6 billion.
Huh? Keep in mind, I am not attesting for the chart on the side. I'm not testing it. I just copied that.
On Earth, so.
And Sue has already found mistakes on it.
Tell how big
so everything else is fine.
Sue Ellen is also. Tell Sue what she needs to hear if she wants to.
All right, Abram, if you could give me a thumbs up, if you can pick up my audio, okay. Well, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for a very, very kind introduction and for inviting me over. I'm just a little bit hesitant. I don't know if you guys are really going to be grateful for me coming and talking to you. I'm actually going to take you to some pretty dark places. So please be gentle with me, and if for whatever reason you choose to withdraw applause at the end, I will be very understanding. Okay, so I changed the title here a little bit from fake news, social media, misinformation. And this is more kind of like a subtitle, really, foreign intervention in 2020, US election, how different will it be from 2016? Okay, so we'll have this. So let me just start by reminding you of the myth of Theseus and the labyrinth and the Minotaur. If you remember that ancient Greek story, on the island of Crete, a labyrinth was built to contain a monster, a half bull, half human, who regularly asked for Athenian youth, both boys and girls, to be sacrificed to him so he could devour them. And in the myth, Theseus is sent out to slay the Minotaur. The catch is that this labyrinth is so disorienting, so confusing, even Daedalus, the creator of the labyrinth, had a hard time getting out, right? So in order for Theseus to go into the labyrinth and slay the Minotaur, Ariadne gave him a special threat made of gold, so that once he has done the deed, he goes out, follows the threat out, and he's scot-free. Now, I know what you're thinking, I think. You're thinking, Trump is the Minotaur. And this entire presidency is one big disorienting labyrinth. Well, yes and no. I suppose you could think that. I would say that at the very best, President Trump is the shadow of the Minotaur. Really what we're dealing with is a condition, a complete breakdown in our civic discourse. So that arguments, facts, figures, things that are verifiable no longer matter. And it's all about impressions and creating fake impressions, fabricating evidence. You know, being in a state of constant disorientation. So that's the monster, that's the Minotaur, right? And here, what I'm trying to do is going and trying to find a way, not only so that we can deal with this, but and President Trump and his presidency, but the seven Trumps that are going to follow after him. We're talking about not just assessing and minimizing the damage, containing, preventing as well. So another thing, okay, the thread of Ariadne, that golden thread, what is it? I cannot give it to you. I have some suspicion as to what it would look like, right? The thing that you have to keep in mind is that I am stuck in the labyrinth along with you all and several hundred or million of our fellow Americans and really the entire world. So what is going to be the way out? Okay, so things that are echo of my previous presentation, we have, for instance, the Intelligence Community Assessment of 2018, you know, it was 17, assessing Russian activities and tensions in recent U.S. elections. We have the Mueller report now, which was subject of congressional hearings. We have a chance to digest it. Raise your hand if you had a chance to at least leaf through the Mueller report. Okay, there is a lot of black ink there, is it, covering major passages. Passages are pertaining to the presentation. Does anybody remember what is written on top of those big black blocks above in text? Those big black blocks blocking text that have been redacted.
Privacy.
It's that ongoing investigation is the thing that I see most often, right? So we're talking about something that's still alive that we're dealing with. So, right, we have some excellent resources that have been given to you, and I really appreciate those things given out in terms of definitions, in terms of social media, so you can identify some of this language. I'm going to add some stuff in addition to that, in my appreciation to the team that put this together. Okay, so for instance, studies by Badway, Errata, Lerman, Spouse 2008, University of Southern California, study of 43 million election-related Twitter posts from September 16 to October 21st of 2016. With 5.7 million distinct users. They include accounts identified with Russian agents. And this is indeed echoed by the committee report as well as the Mueller investigation. So we found out in this analysis that conservatives retweeted Russian trolls 31 times more often than liberals, right? They produce approximately 36 times more tweets than people advocating for Hillary Clinton and other Democratic candidates in their campaign. Troll contents, they seem to be originated from all over the country, really all over the world, but for some reason, all these things are pegged to Tennessee and Texas, right? 4.6% of this content was liberal, identified as liberal, 6.2% conservative users were bots. What is a bot? It is not a real person, it's an automated system whose job it is to harvest information, post it, and propagating. So we're seeing the actions of not a real person, but something that has been programmed in order to harvest information and then disseminate it in a particular way. And those trolls had mostly conservative pro-Trump views, right? So these are all things that we have there. Some more vocabulary over here. The Internet Research Agency, which features prominently in the Mueller report. We know, and this is now established fact, there's no witch hunt here. This is connected to the Kremlin in an information warfare campaign. So if your idea is that here you have essentially a bunch of teenagers in a basement somewhere in Russia that are spraying malicious information, this is really wrong. This, we're talking about an industrial scale campaign, media campaign, right, that involved millions of dollars and had reached up to, in 2016, reached 10 million users. And this is something that's still going on, and sort of like fish out some content directly from the report. Okay, just to do this, I'm going to just read from one of the sections, and it says about the IRA, November 2017, after the election, a Facebook representative testified that posts between January 2015 and August 2017, Facebook estimated that the IRA reached as many as 126 million users through its Facebook accounts. In January of 2018, Twitter announced that it had identified 3,814 IRA-controlled Twitter accounts. You can count that most of them are bots, and notified approximately 1.4 million people Twitter believe may have been in contact with IRA-controlled account. So this is still something that is ongoing, right? Let's see. A few things, for instance, you can even begin to discern patterns in what you have. So for instance, this is from analysis from the House Intelligence Committee. This is in terms of data based on campaign start. Notice this is the date, and this is going to be numbers in thousands, okay, of how many clicks on Russian Facebook ads. Click, 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 click. That's what we're doing. So you can see that things were kind of quiet in 2016. Oh, a few things began to happen in April and July. Then all of a sudden something happened in October, right? You can actually know what it was around that time, and that is sort of like the announcement that from an FBI director that Hillary Clinton, you know, we're looking into her account, right? All of these things are essentially echoing and position themselves to repeat information about something that allegedly is happening with the Hillary campaign. The thing that's amazing about this is that it doesn't stop in November. It's ramping up, all right? So this is something that's still going on, okay? So Facebook, what does, who's this person, by the way? What does he have to say about this? Let me just pull out, show like a video to see what he has to say, and I'm hoping that it is going to come out.
I wish I could keep telling you that our mission in life is connecting people, but it isn't. We just want to predict your future behaviors. Spectre showed me how to manipulate you into sharing intimate data about yourself and all those you love for free. The more you express yourself, the more we own you.
Okay, well, isn't that honesty refreshing? There's only one catch, and those of you who follow the news know what is the catch. What is the catch?
It's all fake.
Yeah. What do you mean fake?
It wasn't him.
This is an example of something that's called a deep fake, which is going to be the main thrust of our presentation. Right? Essentially what this team has done is essentially, can I start from here? Oh, I don't know if I can start from here. No, I don't want to start from the beginning. Start from current slides. Thing about this is that what you do now with technology is that it's possible to scan a face, right? So map all the muscles, the surface, the texture, the hair, all of that, right? And superimpose it on other video. And you can cause that face, the muscles represented digitally, to move around to, say, a voice actor or a piece of software that has been carefully crafted to reproduce precisely the sound of an individual, all right? So you can see where this is going to be trouble. This wasn't in place in 2016. I think a lot of things that we saw in 2016 are going to happen, but the cat is out of the bag, right? We should brace for a surprise, and things that are particularly disorienting, because if they can do this to good old Mark here, guess who is going to face it? Right? So this is a situation kind of where we were right here. So deepfake. So here's another video, and I'm going to break this video into parts, into a couple places, if I could please. Okay, so this is from this past spring, I believe. This is the PBS news report. So let's see, I am hoping that this thing is going to like it. And I do not know if it's going to like it. I think this is it.
Deepfakes. Nope. Are you familiar with that term?
No, that's the wrong one. Is this it?
There is growing alarm over the use of altered videos online, especially those known as deep fakes, which are highly realistic looking and inaccurate. There are concerns about their growing sophistication and the risk they pose to national security. It is the focus of a hearing tomorrow in the House Intelligence Committee. Miles O'Brien has a look at how those videos, once the source of some fun, are being manipulated, and how artificial intelligence scientists are trying to respond. It's part of our weekly segment on the leading edge of science.
All right, let's see you being me. Scary as deepfake videos may be, there are times when they can be fun. A place where a 3D model of my face gets electronically plastered onto computer scientist Hao Li's head, making him the puppet master and me the dummy.
Really a scary looking individual overall. What do you think?
I do need to change my hair, don't I?
Yeah.
Li is an associate professor at the University of Southern California and co-founder of Pinscreen, an app that allows consumers to make instant custom 3D avatars for virtual reality gaming and shopping.
So now you've created your avatar?
So happy right
now. Nice trim, Miles O'Brien. The real-time puppet master trick is how he refines the technology.
And here I am, as our president. Yeah. Shinzo Abe, Prime Minister of Japan. Mm-hmm. Zhang, leader of China. Trudeau? That's not a bad look for me. Me as Justin Bieber, what do you think? I think I'm going to do this on the news air all the time now. This will be good for my career. Lee says he never saw it as anything more than entertainment.
Of course, it can be used for something really bad, but the main purpose was never for that. It was used to use for entertainment, a fun tool that could give us more things to do for fashion, lifestyle, etc.
Deepfake videos cleverly combine what's real with what is synthesized by a computer to make people appear to say things they never did or never would.
I like vodka.
The ever-increasing speed of computers, along with the advancement of the artificial intelligence technique called machine learning, is making these composites harder and harder to detect with the naked eye.
We all assume that there will be a point where there's no way to tell the difference. I mean, for visual effects, I think you can get pretty close already. It's just the question of how much effort you put into it, but in terms of content that can be created by anyone, I think it's getting very close to the point.
This was very truly surprising for me.
One technique is the face swap, which puts Steve Buscemi's face on Jennifer Lawrence's body, Nicolas Cage onto a series of marquee stars in iconic roles.
Terrific.
Or Jimmy Kimmel's mug on mine.
So I've had to relearn very simple things.
But there is a deep, dark side as well. Indeed, the technology has been used to paste the faces of celebrities onto the bodies of porn stars. Computer scientist Hani Farid is a professor at Dartmouth College.
I am worried about the weaponization, and I'm worried about how it's impacting us as a society. So we are working as hard as possible to detect these things.
Killmonger was right.
This video crystallized much of the deep concern. What seems to be President Barack Obama making a speech...
You see, I would never say these things.
...is actually comedian and filmmaker Jordan Peele doing his excellent Obama impersonation synced with software created with artificial intelligence, or AI.
The AI system synthesized the mouth of President Obama to be consistent with the audio stream, and it made it look like President Obama was saying things that he never said. That's called a lip sync deep fake.
Just this week, the technique was used to put some pretty outrageous and comical words into the mouth of Facebook founder Mark Zuckerberg.
Spectre showed me that whoever controls the data controls the future.
It's a potent technology that is ripening at a time of deep polarization and suspicion fueled by social media.
So it's really sad. Here's the thing.
Just last month, something much less sophisticated than a deep fake, a doctored video of House Speaker Nancy Pelosi making her seem drunk, went viral.
We want to give this president the opportunity to do something historic.
Deep fakes ratchet up the risks.
The nightmare situation is that there's a video of President Trump saying, I've launched nuclear weapons against North Korea. And somebody hacks his Twitter account, and that goes viral, and in 30 seconds we have global nuclear meltdown. Do I think it's likely? No. But it's not a zero probability. And that should scare the bejesus out of you, right?
Oh, wonderful. Okay. All right, so yes, we are. It's actually going to get darker than this. Okay, brace yourself, folks. It is a couple of points about this, because my mind has actually changed on this issue somewhat. Because I do some scientific computing where the computations are so big, right, that I have to essentially put several computer clusters together. Right, not just one CPU, many CPUs, and sometimes I use a computing facility in Texas to do my stuff over there. And I'm trying to get a sense of the following. So all discussion right here in terms of kind of like how it will impact a national campaign with deliberate misrepresentation of candidates from both sides, all right? What I'm worried is that, and I cannot really report to you fully what how big this, how concerned we should be, but I'm wondering whether the technology has advanced to such a level, right, that it's not just national campaign with deepfakes of national candidates, that some of the stuff is going to start percolating down ticket, right? And my worry was that, well, it's never going to be, for instance, at the level of, say, a county commissioner race, because it's going to take a lot of computing power. It's not something that you can just take your desktop CPU and just do it on an evening, right? It's probably going to have to commandeer a lot of days to do this. However, it is possible. It is possible now to purchase that amount of computing time rather cheaply on the cloud through such services such as AWS, Amazon Web Services, and all of that, right? So at what point will you get to be worried, right? Where it comes to down ticket elections. You saw what happened with when they were talking about women, right, stars, and this coming from the porn industry. By the way, the main impetus for this technology to begin with did not come from Hollywood. It came from the porn industry, right, essentially going after celebrities, right, and superimposing their faces on actresses, porn actresses. Right? Now imagine what the impact is, the emotional impact on those women, those celebrities are, when these things begin to circulate. Now imagine a circumstance where we're talking about a minor. Right? Imagine a circumstance, for instance, that it's not even celebrities anymore. Right? There is an entire category called revenge porn. Right? So essentially, when you start to hear cases, for instance, of this type of technology being deployed on high school students across the country, you know that people have developed the capacity to impact local races, right? And then how you're going to manage that. That's the stuff. That is the stuff that is causing deep concern. So a little bit of language in terms of adversarial messaging technology. I'm calling it adversarial messaging technology. Okay, so deepfake, a video that has been digitally manipulated to impersonate a personality so well that it might be difficult for the average viewer to tell it is fake, right? Cheap fake. What you saw with Nancy Pelosi this past spring, that was a cheap fake because that did not involve any kind of sophistication in terms of mapping the faces or anything like that, right? And mapping the faces of and superimpose it. All you have to do is do some clever editing with kind of slowing or expanding or snipping text, right, to create a complete misrepresentation of this. So just to give you a little bit more sense, maybe I'll just bring the video back so you can see a little bit more of what that actually looks like on the other end.
The fact that that is not impossible is really worrisome.
Fareed is most worried about deepfakes rearing their ugly head during the 2020 election. So he and his team are carefully learning the candidates' patterns of speech and how they correlate with gestures as a way to spot deep fakes.
We do that, of course, by analyzing hundreds of hours of video of individuals. We're focused on building models for all of the major party candidates so that we can upload a video to our system. We can analyze it by comparing it to previous interviews and then asking what is the probability that this is consistent with everything we've seen before.
Computer scientists have pushed this technology using generative adversarial networks, or GANs. A GAN pits two artificial intelligence algorithms against each other. One strives to create realistic fake images, while the other grades the effort.
So the synthesis engine says, I'm going to create a fake image. I give it to this AI system that says, this looks fake to me. So it goes back and you change it, and you do that a few billion times in rapid succession. And the computers are teaching each other how to make better fakes, and that's what has democratized access.
And that's why the Pentagon is interested in deep fakes. Its research enterprise, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, or DARPA, is exploring ways to defend against the threat of deep fakes. Computer scientist Matt Turek runs DARPA's Media Forensics, or Metaphor, project.
So there's an opportunity here for us to essentially lose all trust in images and video.
Turek showed me some of the 70 counter deepfake techniques DARPA is helping nurture.
Necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another.
This software is designed to characterize lip movement and compare it to the audio.
And so when we see these red bars, that means actually that the sounds of the speaker are not actually consistent with the movement of the lips.
Take a look at this video. Supposedly two people sitting together. But software that determines the lighting angle on faces concludes it is a composite.
So it estimates a 3D model for the face. Along with that 3D model, it estimates the reflectance properties of the face and also the lighting angles. And so here we're primarily using the lighting angles to see whether those are consistent or not.
In this example, video apparently gathered by a security camera shows only one car. This artificial intelligence algorithm is designed to predict how things should move.
What that's triggering off of is discontinuities in the motion. And so that gives us a signal to look at an image or video and say, well, perhaps frames were removed.
And it flags the video as altered. Another vehicle was edited out.
There's a cat and mouse game. The more aspects that you can use to debunk an image or video, the more burden that you put on the manipulator.
But none of these ideas will work without the cooperation of the big social media platforms, YouTube and Facebook, which would need to deploy the software and delete the fakes, something Facebook refused to do when the Pelosi video emerged.
The platforms have been, for the most part, very cavalier about how they deal with this type of illegal content, harmful content, misinformation, fake news, election tampering, non-consensual pornography, and the list goes on, because it gets eyes on the platform, and that's good for business.
A fake video, amplified in an echo chamber, can go an awfully long way before the facts even enter the picture. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Miles O'Brien in Los Angeles.
All right, so let the horse continue. Okay, so more vocabulary here. So more things that were in the video. Face swap, in a video superimposing a face of another person onto the other, but matching facial movements of the new face with those of the underlying face, all right? Lip syncing, matching mouth movements of speech, sorry for the misspelling over there, pardon my grammar, face to match that of a voice actor on an audio track. Right, and here are some more terms. So media forensics is going to be an important vocabulary term that you need to know, right? Everybody repeat after me the following phrase. Pending a media forensics investigation.
Media forensics investigation.
You are going to be hearing that phrase often, right? Especially up to the 2020 election. You may have to use it when addressing the general public in an election, right? Get used to that type of language, right? More vocabulary, which is somewhat confusing. Generative adversarial nets, okay? Oh, wait a second. AI deepfake ID algorithms. Co-trained using neural networks to identify inconsistencies by comparing several verified videos and discover deepfakes. You probably saw when I first showed you that Zuckerberg video that had been doctored, right? There's something not quite right. And it's hard for you to actually pinpoint that, right? But you have to be primed to actually hunt for it. Yes?
It was
Zapat. It's
kind of off a little.
Yeah, it's off a little, right? So we're talking about essentially neural networks. Yeah, you're talking about neural networks whose job it is to essentially scan frame by frame and sound bit by sound bit for anything that seems off, right? The thing about this, though, is that adversarial networks kind of work like this. Right, often what happens is that you have an artificial intelligence algorithm using neural networks. Essentially, you dump a whole bunch of data onto that network. The neural network has to kind of like explore to try to identify things. So for instance, you could use an AI, for instance, to scan lots and lots of x-rays to find a cancer tumor based upon patterns, right? You could, right? Except what happens when the AI misses it. Right, and then who's responsible for something that, say, a trained eye would identify right away? Right, you could see the direction where some of these things could go. But we're coming from this adversarial networks that we're talking about. Essentially, what you use is that you have a network whose job it is to generate the fake video, and then you have another network who essentially assesses the likelihood that something coming from it is real or fake. Right? So when you use these things close together, you can become better at becoming something that is not even off. You have crossed the uncanny valley, it looks perfectly normal, looks like the real thing. And of course, the vast majority of people don't even have a language to be able to show identify this, right? So that is something that is that we have to watch out for. Okay, so deception levels on candidates. So let's talk about deception levels of what you could expect. Here's, I think, what we should be very clear about this from the get-go when talking about the 2020 election campaign. The focus has been on the Trump organization, the Trump campaign, receiving assistance, potentially, from Russian operatives, right? And that has been the focus of it. I think that we should be ready for the following scenario, because what the 2016 election has demonstrated is that the Russian government, with minimal investment, can actually impact the U.S. electoral system enough to get some very important geopolitical gains. But why should Russia be the only one? There are other countries that have interest. Essentially, it's open season on American democracy, right? Because the Chinese also have interests. So does Israel, so does Saudi Arabia, so does Pakistan. You know, essentially, you could have multiple state actors want to intervene, and they may even choose to intervene in favor of an American Democratic candidate for presidency. You see where we're going at, right, and what we need to brace ourselves, because when that situation happens, we need to be able to respond quite promptly for that scenario and have language ready by which we can explain to our fellow Americans what is the impact of these things as well, right? So a deception level. Right, so I identify a few deception levels. Kind of goes like this. Zero deception level. What's that all about? So the purpose is to misrepresent candidate words or views to all audiences. Right? That's the purpose. Zero level. There is higher order levels, right? So for instance, you can imagine, for instance, someone going on and taking President Trump and doing something, seeing something saying awful, but then he says things awful all the time, so how can you tell anyway, right? But you can imagine that doing it for
Twitter is sure. Zero level.
There we go, it's a zero level. So of like misrepresentation, right? So misrepresentation, all audiences are the target. You know, let's make sure that Nancy Pelosi appears to that to all audience. That's a serious level. First level, right? The purpose is to misrepresent the candidates, but make the deception so easy to detect, so as to drive sympathy for the candidate. Oh man, Nancy Pelosi really got hurt on that. I feel sympathetic towards her. Let's go and support our speaker. Now let's do that, right? So that would be that level. And you could say, well, who was the person who actually set up the deception? Was it someone from the Trump campaign? Was it a Russian or Chinese operative, right? You can even imagine higher order levels of deception, right? So it's like, Nancy Pelosi really wanted someone to do that, to make the Trump campaign and the Republican Party so awful that she will get political gains out of that. You see how you get over this? And all of a sudden, you're in a funhouse meteor of things that are disconcerting, where you have no certainty, that inspires conspiracy theories, and all of that, right? So here's, for instance, show of like a quick chart of show of like possible deception scenarios. So essentially, you have on the top row on these columns are the candidate that you want to favor. Could be a state actor, could be the campaign themselves, could be some independent actors that have not been identified. You want this particular candidate to benefit, right? Zeroth level deception. In that case, if you want the Democrat to come forward, then you have a GOP candidate with a high deep fake, so that it's very hard to tell that the GOP is being misrepresented, right? Or you could have someone that really wants the GOP to win. In that case, that candidate will have the Democratic candidate in a high deepfake, right? Or you could have the following scenario, right? You want the Democrat to win, and hence, you are going to set up a Democratic candidate with a poor deepfake so that you create the effect that this person is being unfairly targeted, let's rally around her or him, right? Likewise over here. And the thing about this, it doesn't have to stop. Oh, man. The thing about this, though, is that those of you who write columns to the editor, right, who want to influence the public discourse, now is the time to start formulating in your head how you're going to explain various scenarios, any one of these scenarios, to the public. Let's be clear. If you have a state actor or non-state actor intervening in the U.S. election in favor of a Democratic candidate, they're not doing you any favors. First off, it's wrong and immoral.
What?
It's wrong and immoral and illegal, right? At third level, you're creating a circumstance by which if you choose to accept that, you are going to cause a situation where the legitimacy of a potentially new Democratic president is going to need in order for her to actually run the country. Or him. It might be a him. You never know, right? So the thing about this is that now's the time to start thinking along those terms and working out through various scenarios. That will be your homework for the next 15 months. All right. Oh, no. Okay. So here's the thing, though. All right. So in this Mirror Has Universe, I mean, just for you guys deserve some comic relief. You guys need some comic relief. I think you could use some comic relief, right? All right. So this thing's right here, the deep fakes, right? And this product out there, they are meant to deceive. They essentially are like poison. Poison on a goblet. Where is the poison? And just to see just how you can get caught in something, something very strange. Here you have a clip. It is a clip from The Princess Bride, where Rossini and Wesley are show of duking out in the Battle of Wits to figure out where the poison is on the goblet. So let's just see if we can follow the logic of Rossini, if you can, please.
What you do not smell is called iocane powder. It is odorless, tasteless, dissolves instantly in liquid, and is among the more deadly poisons known to man. Where is the poison? The Battle of Wits has begun. It ends when you decide and we both drink and find out who is right and who is dead.
But it's so simple. All I have to do is divine from what I know of you. Are you the sort of man who would put the poison into his own goblet or his enemies? Now, a clever man would put the poison into his own goblet because he would know that only a great fool would reach for what he was given. I'm not a great fool, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you. But you must have known I was not a great fool. You would have counted on it, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
You made your decision then?
Not remotely. Because iocane comes from Australia, as everyone knows. And Australia is entirely peopled with criminals. And criminals are used to having people not trust them, as you are not trusted by me, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you.
Truly, you have a dizzying intellect.
Wait till I get going!
Where was I? Australia.
Yes, Australia. And you must have suspected I would have known the powder's origin, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you.
You're just stalling now.
You'd like to think that, wouldn't you? You've beaten my giant, which means you're exceptionally strong. So you could have put the poison in your own goblet, trusting on your strength to save me, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you. But you've also bested my Spaniard, which means you must have studied. And in studying, you must have learned that man is mortal. So you would have put the poison as far from yourself as possible, so I can clearly not choose the wine in front of me.
You're trying to trick me into giving away something. What work?
It has worked. You've given everything away. I know where the poison is.
Then make your choice.
I will. And I choose. What in the world can that be?
What? Where? I don't see anything.
I saw something. No matter.
What's so funny?
I'll tell you in a minute.
It's going a little long, sorry.
Let's drink. Me from my glass, and you from yours.
Where's the poison? Those of you who've seen the movie, don't say that loud.
Guess wrong.
You only think I guess wrong. That's what's so funny. I switched glasses when your back was turned. Ha ha, you fool. You fell victim to one of the classic blunders. The most famous is never get involved in a land war in Asia, but only slightly less well known is this. Never go in against a Sicilian when death is on the line.
Okay. All right. Have you ever had a Twitter argument along those lines?
Who are you?
I'm no one to be trifled with. As though you ever need no.
Just think. Who
that time it was Shortcut that was poisoned.
They were both poisoned. I spent the last few years building up an immunity to Iokin.
All right, there we go. So what's the lesson? It's all poison, actually. This technology is all poison. So and you don't want to be caught into any of this stuff if you can actually help it. So what are some resources that you want to use? Oh, wait, hold on a second. Some resources that you want to use, okay? So I'm going to share some resources with you. A journalist colleague over at Western Carolina University, Kata Spaskowska, has shared this with me. Deepfake technology is changing fast. Use 5 resources to keep up. This is oriented towards journalists as well. So as a reference, if those of you who are taking notes, this is going to be a link that you can use to access that. What they have here is essentially a compendium of sites that essentially catalog and track developments of technology as well as examples of deepfake, right? So this is what we need to have in our arsenal. And that, as we go into 2020, is that we need to have a way in which when something starts to show up on your Twitter or Facebook or Instagram feed that looks suspicious, that potentially could even impact local elections or down-ticket elections, right? The national campaigns can only do so much, can they? Right? We need to be able to track this phenomenon, show up at the level as well. Okay. I'm going to just pause real quickly to see if anybody has any questions while people write down. Yes, Roy.
Is there any backtracking to source, via the IP?
There's any number of things, but this is the way that you operate. You have something called the virtual private network,
right?
Which is a way of essentially disguising your tracks along the internet, right? So I could set it up so that I can deploy something from, say, coming from Italy as opposed to an IP address based in Italy as opposed to something based on a Sylva, right? I could, right? So that's going to be tracked. There has been legislation that has been proposed. For instance, there is a legislation that was essentially introduced but never went past committee, I believe, to essentially mandate that deepfake videos like this actually have some kind of watermark that identify them as deepfake. Right, so these are things that constitutionally, legally, we are still in limbo. This is no man's land. Actually, this is no man's land as well. Another thing I want to say about this technology, it has to go like this. Okay, I think about deepfake and the fact that it comes from the porn industry. And actually, those of us who rely on video from the internet, whether it be from Netflix, YouTube, whatnot, right? The essential architecture, the file formats, the convention by which images get sent out, right, were developed by the porn industry in the late 1990s, early 2000s. We are essentially reckoning by technology that was meant to do something very specific, which worries me somewhat. Right, I want to share, okay, a theory. This theory has to be wrong. I'm actually ashamed that I invented it. Right, please do not use this theory. It is suspect in its theoretical foundations. Its evidence is retroactive and scant. Please do not use this theory by yourself. There's only one reason why I want to share this theory, which fills me with horror. It kind of goes like this. The Trump administration, like all drugs, has to come increasingly awful because you build up resistance to the increased awfulness. Things that would have destroyed previous presidencies happen on a weekly basis sometimes, without any process of accountability, and it is disorienting, right? So you have to become really good about generating potentially really alarming, disturbing scenarios and see how you handle on the ground. The thing about this is that this theory is not going to keep you from being shocked, because you will be shocked, or actually even predict exactly what's going to happen. What is going to hopefully help you do is imagine scenarios so awful that you'll be shocked, but you will not be paralyzed, because you will know what to do. And the last thing that you want to do is for you to be paralyzed. I'm calling this theory, quote unquote, the pornographic presidency, right? And here I'm not saying that President Trump is, the theory doesn't say that President Trump is a vulgar character. He is, right? But that's not what this thing is all about. Right? Essentially, it's a way of trying to explain why is it that certain issues dominate? Why is it that we have such emotional reactions, both people in favor of an action from the president or against something? Of all the things that are happening in the background, why certain things dominate, right? And we have to do with not about ideas, we have to talk about images, right? To the extent that you can say that the president has any intelligence at all, it's about image manipulation, not ideas, right? He doesn't have to be a billionaire, he just has to convince enough of us that he is, or that he is a good businessman for that matter, right? You know, what this thing is going to apply is not going to be for the US population as a whole. I would say that it only targets about perhaps even only 10%, if not less, of the US population, but it might be a population that makes a difference. So essentially it says that the focus of campaign on issues around images that make reference to themes in the culture of pornography for their capacity to trigger emotional states. So essentially it's a theory about hijacking your central neural system, right? And the hijacking not just of his supporters, but people in the opposition, right? And why am I focusing on pornographic images? How big of a deal can this be, right? The thing about this is that most people do not know the extent of pornographic consumption in the United States, or the world for that matter. We don't, right? It is happening. If I were to give you a number in terms of millions, of say hours viewed or something like that, it probably is not going to make a lot of sense. We are sucked up in a media environment anyway, right? So just to give you sort of like a sense, right? So this is a study from the University of Bristol from this past couple weeks, right? Let's talk about YouTube, just this technology right here, right? YouTube and seeing things on YouTube is a fundamentally different technology for delivering images than what you're used to with, say, receiving radio waves from a TV station antenna. It's much more computationally and energetically expensive, right? You only, with antenna or even, say, satellites coming from space, you only have a tiny amount of energy to deliver the content onto a very wide population. But say with Netflix, YouTube, Amazon Prime Video, all this stuff, it is very computationally expensive because every time a user prompts the network or the server for a particular image or a video, that has to be processed computationally, so it gets piped in via fiber optic cables, so it is expensive, right? And it actually has an environmental impact that's measurable. So for instance, YouTube, all the consumption on YouTube, right? Just to give you a sense, in terms of energy, comes to about annually right now, and it's increasing, of 11 million tons of CO2. 11 million tons that get set out over there. All right, some calculations I sat down and do this because this report also looked at internet pornography. So if you look at all the video of the internet, all the video on the internet, all the stuff over there, the total consumption comes roughly to about 300 million tons of CO2, which is the energy consumption of the entire country of Spain. Okay, let's talk about porn. How much porn is being consumed over here? So I made the calculation, right, in terms of based upon the study of those numbers. How many tons of CO2 get sent out into the atmosphere every year currently that is dedicated entirely to send pornographic video down the internet worldwide? You know, and that comes out roughly to about, from my calculation, to about, oh, where is it? 81 million tons of CO2, right? To give you some sense, right, the Earth took the entire biosphere of the Earth took 595 years to store enough carbon in the soil for it to be released in 1 year entirely on internet pornography consumption. That's not the worst part. The worst part is that subsequent generations are going to have to spend huge amount of resources on geoengineering projects sequestering that carbon back in order for us to get climate stability. And you can imagine scenario 200 years and saying it's like, mommy, daddy, why do we have to work so much in this carbon sequestration thing? And they are going to say, well, this year we're putting away all the carbon that was released because of internet porn consumption in 2017, right? It's that kind of stuff. So there's a lot of stuff out there just to sort of give you sort of a sense of scale of this. So in this scenario, essentially what it means, right? There's a lot of stuff out there that's not being referenced, but the idea is that the campaign does not have to present you pornographic images. It doesn't have to deliver it. All it has to do is reference it. So you can imagine the following scenario, right? I'm not saying that this needs to happen, should happen, but let's suppose that Senator Cory Booker wins the nomination for President of the United States in the fall of 2020, right? Let's suppose that the week he gets the nomination, there is a deepfake video about him making lewd comments about white women. And you know what that's going to do. Now, in the best possible scenario that I can imagine, the following is going to be true. Enough is invested in there that within 24 hours, media forensics is going to identify that video as fake, right? And it's going to be disseminated. Hopefully, if things work out, Twitter, Facebook, all these platforms are going to essentially block all release of that particular video. If things work out well, that video will be accessible, though, through virtual networks and all stuff. So that video is going to exist. And even if you do the work of establishing that this is a fake video, just the idea that it exists is enough to shift people's perception about this. Because essentially the message is not even necessarily what Senator Booker actually believes or thinks about white women, right? Ultimately, the message is, what do some unknown white men who run things in the background, what do they think about another black man running for president, right? And the thing about this is that people in white communities, my interpretation of this is that they receive lots of cues all the time from other white people around them as to what to think or how to treat people of color, right? So this is the scenario we're sort of talking about this. Or things having to do with sort of this as well, and something that you, I believe we sort of worry about this. So there's a couple of ideas, or at least observations about show what impacts, for instance, women's issues in the campaign and things of that nature. It kind of goes like this. How is porn actually consumed? It's usually a private thing. Women can do it, but they say the target is mostly men, right? How do you interact? They interact it privately. There's only so many interactions you could have. You can click, you can stop, you can fast forward, you can end. The thing about this is that, say, a 10-minute pornographic clip. You know where it stops, and you can predict where it's going to end. Right. The thing about this is that there are no prompts about this particular videos that will help the audience ask the following question, right? Was it good? Was it a good experience? Was it valuable? Were people heard about this? Okay, what was their life before this encounter? What's life after? It seems that if you have massive consumption of this type of media, you end up conditioning an audience to the following. Right? And if we're talking about primarily about men, and we're talking about women's bodies and women's lives, you can end up with a fallen circumstance in the sense that you condition a male audience to think that the lives of women, their inner lives, either do not exist or do not matter. And I think that has impacts in the lives of women when we talk about not just relationships, but also things having to do in the workplace, the whole discussion about sexual harassment, the Me Too movement. I think in the background, all these pornographic images are sort of floating in people's heads, right? That's what happened. And one of the things, for instance, that I think happens as well is that we're dealing with these emotions as well, looking at the brain and what the brain actually does, right? Two things I want to highlight. The basal ganglia, emotion, memory, pattern recognition. This is what you target with pornographic consumption. The thing that you want to suppress and shut down, or at least keep quiet, is the prefrontal cortex, the decision-making, motoring social behavior that allows you to think about the consequences of your consumption, right? And if there's anything about the pornographic consumption, kind of goes like this. Not only do you not think about the characters, you also end up not thinking about the actors themselves. Are they happy? Is this consensual? Is that something they want to do? How is it affecting their lives? Are they being treated well, right? Are they being paid fairly or even at all, right? These are all things that are essentially shut down through this, and I think that has consequences for how we consume the media because we are essentially keeping people from doing that moral reasoning. So, oh boy, I need to give you some hope, don't I, right?
Yeah.
I need to give you some hope, right? The walls of the labyrinth, things about this. What do I think is in the walls of the labyrinth, right? The walls of the labyrinth. Well, this is not going to be all inclusive, but these are essentially the following concepts: white fragility, masculine fragility, Christian fragility. When I use these terms, I want to be really, really clear about this. I am not saying that white people are essentially delicate, fragile, can be destroyed easily, do not deserve respect or attention a lot. I am not saying the same thing about men. I'm not saying that men are necessarily weak or incapable of moral judgment or essentially will evaporate at the closest things, or the same thing about people who identify as being Christian. I am not saying none of these things, but, and as a matter of fact, what I'm talking about is a very specific very narrow neurological phenomenon, because this is not a belief, right? If you think about a cup, right? The cup can't just sit there, right? Until some kind of disturbance happens. You knock it down, your cat does its job. And then what happens, it breaks, right? You get sort of an instantaneous response about that. And we have had, for instance, experience. I've had experience, English is not my first language, I came here from Mexico. I've had, for instance, experience, something that should be very familiar if you follow the news. You know, of someone hearing me speak in Spanish in the public space, and someone coming up to me and saying, this is America, we speak English here. You know, I don't want to hear that language from you, right? It has happened to me several times, right? But where's this response coming from? It's coming from a sense of fragility, right? That somehow the existence of someone who is other or behavior that's normative over there is somehow extremely threatening, right? And we see, for instance, with things about, say, masculine fragility and the whole phenomenon. Do I need to mansplain to this audience mansplaining? Do I even need to do that? Okay, all right, that's tough. But a man mansplaining, imagine that. Okay, so a phenomenon like that. So sometimes what my female colleagues report is sometimes over-exaggerated emotional response, you know, towards fairly legitimate concerns that women can bring in the family, in the workplace, in the family, all of that, that seem to come from somewhere else, over the top. Where's that? And of course, we see things, for instance, this phenomenon of fragility, right? People who lose their wits when they see a woman wearing a hijab, or say, someone wearing a jamoka or the Star of David. I've encountered those people who've seen all the time. Or say, it is the end of July, aren't we overdue now for the war on Christmas? And that whole discussion, right? That is fragility over there. So I want to make the following sort of proposition, right? And it kind of goes like this, right? That there's an alternative. What is a readiness threat? What is the thing that, at least the components of the things that are going to get out of this, is that we can start to find ways in which we can foster the alternatives or the counter responses for that. White resiliency, and from the beginning, it sounds like a white nationalist proposition. It really isn't, because a white resilient person, right, it is not threatened by having people of color in the workplace or in their community, right? They reach out for them, right? They know how to reach out that they express concern. They work with them, right? They are not threatened by bringing issues of equality on the workplace, right? Masculine resiliency. Right, I am not going to be threatened by having female leaders, right, and having female issues in the workplace or in school or any place like that, right? There's got to be models. What we're looking for is models that can demonstrate that, because people are looking for cues, right? Men look to other men for cues as to how they respond to women's concerns and issues. We have to find ways in which to model those behaviors positively, so that we create a culture of resilience against these negative fake images that are coming our way, right? Last one of this show of Christian resiliency, right? Instead of losing your wigs, your wits about having, say, okay, there we go. Well, you could do that. Let me just give you an example of what Christian resiliency actually looks like, right? And when we're talking about finding ways of introducing Christian resiliency, I'm not saying that Christian ministers should essentially advocate for specific candidates. All they have to do is sort of demonstrate things like this. What am I showing you here? If you guys are looking at pictures from the massive protests in Egypt during the Arab Revolution, the Spring Revolution, Arab Spring Revolution in Egypt, right? You have a very dangerous situation. You have mass movement to expel the government. You have soldiers deployed all around you. At the same time, you have a massive demonstration. The thing about this is that Egypt is religiously heterogeneous. You have a fairly large number of Christians as well as the Muslims, right? But here's the thing that happens, right, in this case. Muslims have no choice. If they're going to practice their faith, they must pray a certain times, five times a day. In the middle of the protests, in a situation where guns could have fired at any one time, at that moment for the call of prayer, you have the Muslims, and then you have their Christian community making a circle to protect them at the same time. See, it is this image that I'm turned to as something that would be sort of positive, as something to turn to, right? We need those images. We need those religious leaders to essentially model that resiliency, right? We need those men to essentially model that masculine resiliency so that we're not consumed by negative images or misogyny in our political discourse. And likewise, we could play the same thing about race. And notice what's happening with the discussion about Baltimore right now. What Baltimore right now, and presidents responding on this. Why, with all the things that we have to deal with, why, oh why, are we consumed by this, right? So, I do need to end some kind of like something positive, and I know I'm right over time. This comes from Václav Havel, who was the first president of Czechoslovakia and then the Czech Republic after the fall of communism. He did a speech of hope. Hope. Either we have hope within us or we don't. It is a dimension of the soul, and it's not essentially dependent on some particular observation of the world. Hope is an orientation of the spirit, an orientation of the heart. It transcends the world that is immediately experienced and is anchored somewhere beyond its horizons. Hope in this deep and powerful sense is not the same as joy that things are going well or willingness to invest in enterprises that are obviously headed for early success, but rather an ability to work for something because it is good, because it stands a chance to not because it stands a chance to succeed. Hope is definitely not the same thing as optimism. It is not the conviction that something will turn out well, but certainly certainty that something makes sense regardless of how it turns out. It is hope, above all, which gives the strength to live and continually try new things. Václav Havel. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Bob, I appreciate the question. The question, again, repeated for the audience and the camera, is do I anticipate that both sides in the campaign are going to use it in equal intensity? I sure hope not. It's kind of hard for me to read the TV format as well. The thing about this is that
I have multiple actors, don't they? Campaigns are no longer monolithic. We have multiple parties out there, and now we have foreign agents, foreign operations out there that are also at play in the campaign. So it's kind of hard to answer the question. Yes?
Is there any real difference between dark imaging and dark money and dark all the rest of these things that are available to the campaigns as we speak right now? In other words, without the dark money, you don't get the rest of it. Without the dark, what can I call it? I guess it'd be almost dark treason.
Okay.
Using that word in the loosest sense of the term.
Okay.
A dark treason that allows people to say, I need to win. I will do whatever I need to do with whoever I need to do to win.
So see if I can repeat, Roy, show of capture what you say. So if there's any difference between things called dark money, which I understand to be essentially money going and supporting campaigns without coordinating with them, right? And sort of dark imaging.
Without a source.
Without a source that you can track. Okay. Oh, gosh. Well, certainly now we have shown that dark money in a foreign operation can have a tremendous influence in the U.S. election. So really, our response here is to seek out the other end, seek that transparency, seek that accountability, seek that focus on issues. You know, be in a readiness thread, your way out of the labyrinth. You have to be very deeply grounded on your fundamental principles, the things that you stand for, and be able to model the voicing of those principles for your fellow Americans. And the thing about this is that at this point, I'm thinking it's not just the Democratic Party. I'm thinking about my good friends in the GOP. Right, I see myself as essentially kind of like a salvage operation also for a GOP as well, because I do happen to believe that even though I have profound disagreements, the American conservative movement does have something that needs to be considered in a responsible fashion. So I look forward to the day when we actually have that space again, where we actually talk about issues, where we consider evidence, and we engage in a civic responsible way. And we are not here today as a country. Yeah, yes, I'm sorry.
Well, it was just a brief question asking you as a brief follow-up to, it's kind of a follow-up to that. For those of us who certainly won't be able, I wouldn't be able to talk to someone about an image, et cetera, and say it's deep fake, and here's how we find out, et cetera, et cetera. I might just be able to say to someone, you know, look for this, that thing you made us So would there be, so Enrique, you mentioned then you look forward to the day when we again can sit together, regardless of political party or including whatever it is, and talk with one another about the issue. So to get to my short question, which is a long, short question, what ways would you suggest for us to not focus too much on how things are getting messed up by technology and deepfake, and where would you have us focus instead? Not to ignore this, but where could we focus if we got tired of or couldn't continue the discussion about all of the things?
So where should we focus? I see if I can capture the question. Where do you recommend how we should focus instead of being consumed by discussions of deep imagery, right? Well, how do we pivot? And I do not have one answer for that, right? And it's going to be subject on the place where you inhabit. I would say that, well, let me just put it this. This organization, the Jackson County Democratic Party, along with local parties across the country, right, have something that is very important to this picture. And that is that you are here. You are human beings, right, that you can engage with local people with issues, right? If you think, for instance, about campaigns as being somewhat pornographic, right, there is no way that a user of pornography is ever going to have a satisfying engagement or talk to, say, pornographic content, right? Because there is no connection there, right? Likewise with politics. I think that people are hungering for that human connection. You have something that no political campaign can possibly buy, and that is that you are here and you're committed and you're working and you're seeking out and you're building relationships at the same time that you are working politically. That's the way forward. That's a readiness thread right there. Okay, yes.
Okay.
Jean Ellen, yes.
Yes, this is very personal. I loved what you had about hope. And I strive to live my daily life. And I want to know, in your opinion, and maybe that yourself, do you avoid, I do Twitter a lot, and I get caught up with Amy Siskin, who is so angry every day, and I'm caught up in that. Is it better to let those people go, let that anger go, and follow the Dalai Lama, poets and artists? Okay. What's your personal opinion?
Well, only answer the following way. I do not have the full exposition of this miserable theory. I do not want you to put attention or act on this pornographic presence, right? Let's talk about the child separation policy. Let's talk about what happened last summer, right? All right, when that actually happened, I could not sleep for a week. It was impacting me at so many different levels. And I realized at the time that I did not really have a good practice of presence to be able to negotiate the emotions and be present for my fellow activists that we did this work. So some kind of practice of presence in whatever tradition you can find is probably going to be essential. So I found out that, but our curiosity, and this is how poorly I treat my mental health. After all of these images, this audio, these pictures of children in cages started to come out, I went to certain sites that I know are frequented by Trump space. I talk about 4chan, for instance, sort of anonymous bulletin board, to see how they're responding here. And horror of horrors, those things that I was sure were sufficient to completely discredit the presidency in all eyes, people were having fun with them. And we know, for instance, that there were secret Facebook groups that were used by ICE and Customs Border Patrol, and it's absolutely outrageous. Right. So when we're talking about the pornographic presidency, I'm going to give you one guess. If there is one pornography out there that essentially corresponds to children in cages. Okay, so I'm kind of getting emotional about that. But the fact that you're getting a reaction to it, right, means that there's something there, right? These things happen because they trigger people at deeply emotional level, that point that we start to shut down the prefrontal cortex, which allows us to do that reasoning and relationship. So some kind of practice of presence that essentially connects those parts, those reasoning parts, with other parts of the brain, I think at this point is going to be essential for anybody who does this work.
All right, Karen. Okay.
Yes, Karen.
Are the organizations like factcheck.org gearing up technologically to analyze these media?
I hope that they are. I don't have a quick answer for you, so that would be some homework that you guys can take on. Yeah.
I had a very similar question to Karen about the resources that she mentioned, the value, the prospective value of fact-checking organizations. You know, how they got their resources, are they donation-driven or...
Okay. Well, for instance, let's see. See if I can recap the question for the camera and for other people in the audience. The question is, those resources that I point you guys to, right, how are they funded, right? Reasonable question to ask, it's worthwhile show of investigating. The information that I'm sharing with you is coming from the Shorenstein Center on the Media and Politics and Public Policy. So essentially it's kind of like a public policy outfit, and I'm hoping that they do have, for instance, their books available so that there's transparency as to where their sources are, so you can in fact trust them. You have, for instance, I believe Emory University has a social media observatory, I guess they call it now, the listening center where they gather this information as well. So yes, multiple sources in this case going to be essential, I think. Yes, Roy.
The cognitive dissonance I have between the deep fake, the deep reality that 40% of our country is seemingly in agreement with what, on one of the objectives you just talked about, is to engage, talk about any of those events, those situations, and that people seem to take, if not delight in them, they seem to be good with them. And I can tell you from my 6 years in Germany that that is not a good path for any civilization, beyond. And so, do we really even need a deep fake kind of situation for the election, or are we just having to deal with this 40% of the country that's already there, that doesn't need any kind of new fake imagery
I hope that can show up a combined.
My own frustration or my own sense of pessimism.
So the question coming from Roy has to show pessimism of the 40% of the country that believes these things regardless, and they do not need show of deep fakes in order for them to believe a certain way.
You call it a deep reality.
Show of like deep reality. Well, what is reality? Man, we live in this dark show of mirror, funhouse mirror universe now. So, yeah, I would say that it starts with relationships, show of developing those relationships locally, right? Have that commitment to democratic values, both uppercase D and lowercase d. Live those commitments, live those values, practice them, and essentially mold a behavior. Because at this point, I would say that we're talking about essentially children and youth who are going through this political formation right now. They need models, local models that they can see, flesh, not just people on the screen, as to how to reason, how to conduct themselves in discourse, and how to have that presence.
I have Bob and I have Dan.
Okay, Bob, yes, please.
It seems to me we're in a situation of potential chaos.
Mm-hmm.
And if that's the case, will that suppress voting in the coming election, where people will just say, I don't know what the hell's going on. I can't judge.
Okay, hard to sell. Will things be so disorienting and confused that people will not make a commitment one or the other? That's what happens to a democracy when things like this are weaponized, I would say. Okay.
Yes, Dan? I have maybe a little bit more. And the point being that, you know, this country went through a real cataclysm during the civil rights movement. And it didn't win over a lot of people. But there was enough outrage that there was pressure put on the political establishment to do the right thing, like the Civil Rights Act, even with people that you might not have thought would necessarily have supported that. And I think that, essentially, Trump is going to set himself on fire. And we're going to see just the emperor without the clothes. And
how it's the real emperor.
The laughter might be a way of envisioning Trump without his clothes.
Right. Anybody else? One more.
There might be a deep fake video out there already.
Okay, Jane. Jane. Jane is the last one. Here we go.
I guess to me the difference between that whatever it is, 37%, 40% of the people who are in favor of some of the things that Trump is doing and the people who are in this room is a deep sense of what is right, what is compassionate, that I'm not going to be looking at the fakes and get my mind changed. And what I need, what I think we are, our challenge is going to be to find those people who are deeply compassionate, who do care, and who are willing to try to find those people and get them out to vote. Because that's what's going to, you know, if there's 40% of Trump's people, which does upset me terribly, I didn't know that was happening. I thought, you know, the world was a better place. But that would mean 60% who could think better, who could feel better, who would feel it deeply enough to go out, get off their couches or whatever, and vote, because that's what's going to make the difference.
And with that, thank you very much, Enrique. That was really lovely.
I actually got clapping. I haven't offended you so much or disturbed you so much. Okay,
right,
thank you.
Of-